I don't get out much, so I'm great to be at a conference. It's nice to be at a conference where every other statement you hear is about higher order functions, monads, and rule-based programming. So happy to be here, and I'll be talking about pushing the limits of web browsers in the context of virtual machines. I'll talk about the past, because many of the ideas that we used in V8 and Dart are coming from projects in the 90s, so I'll talk about them too, and hopefully I'll get you excited about the whole area. Oh, first of all, here's a great picture of me I found by Googling myself. It's amazing. I guess you have all tried that, but this is that was the funniest picture I could find. Sadly, but it's true, I spent the last 26 years optimizing object-oriented virtual object-oriented programming languages. That's all I've been doing. And it started all the way back in at the university, where we did a language called Beta, a successor to Simula 67. Have anybody used that here? Not lately. Okay. It was the first object-oriented programming language around. Then I joined the Self Group. It was a research project at Sun Microsystems. And did a startup, did Strongtalk, and a startup, I'll get back to that. And then I worked on the HotSpot JVM, was the tech lead. Did another JVM, high-performance JVM for cell phones called Monty. I think Sun called it CLDC HI. And then I was fed up with big companies and did an embedded Smalltalk system we called OOVM, which was pretty cool, but as you probably know, if you don't have curly braces in your programming language, you cannot sell it. Then I started at Google, did some V8 stuff, and now I'm doing Dart, so let's see how it goes. First of all, I'll just try to explain to you why virtual machines for languages are cool. I'll go back in the past, talk about the Self project and HotSpot, where we got the cool ideas how to make web platforms faster. And then I'll talk about V8 and Dart. And then, since I'm an old guy within this field, I'll talk about what I learned building these VMs. And if I do it fast, there'll be questions afterwards. So, here it is. This is why these VMs are cool, right? It provides platform-independent execution. In the old days, you had to compile to a specific CPU, and that might have been okay for some, but for instance, if you have different kinds of machines, you're stuck. You're basically stuck to using one vendor's machine because you had this pre-compiled code. So virtual machines give you a way of running the same program unchanged on many different pieces of hardware. Another thing it does, it gives you a sandboxing, so you can run in a protected mode if you run on top of a virtual machine, which is pretty hard unless you buy something called VMware or the like. And the third point, which is even cooler, you can do optimizations at runtime. So you can decide what to inline while you're running the program. So given the kind of CPU you have and the memory you have, you can decide which kind of inlining strategy you want. You don't have to do that at compile time. And then you also do debugging after you have sent it out in production. So if a customer finds a problem, you can actually attach to a running VM in production and then figure out what the problem is. And then, of course, the last part, which is cool when it comes to Java and JavaScript and Dart, you can do the loading of third-party code at runtime, and the whole system will adapt to it. It has to throw out part of the code and recompile some new one, but it'll all happen at runtime and work fine. So virtual machines are also cool because if you actually speed them up every quarter, then your program will run faster without changing one line of code. Everybody should like that. And in the context of web applications, it's pretty much fantastic, because that if you actually do a good job of implementing a virtual machine, you get room for more innovation. So the application developers, they can put in more logic in the application and it'll still run fine on the device. So I worked in a Self project. It was a cool research project where we had a prototype-based language called Self. And in that project, some cool ideas got invented. And it was a stage compilation technology where they used inline caching. I guess you all know what that is. Hands up. Who knows what inline caching is? It's a, okay, that's not many. Inline caching is a way of capturing the receiver type at a call and then use the result the next time you get around to that call. So you can optimize the call. It's also a way of collecting type information as you run the program. Inline, you all know what it is. But that's the interesting part is called de-optimization. So if you have a compiler that can do aggressive inlining but can back out of the inline decisions on the fly, you have a very powerful system. And that's exactly what de-optimization is. It's a process of taking one activation that's described by optimized code and then convert the activation into an unoptimized one or several of them on the fly and continue execution as if nothing has happened. What for? Like, for instance, if you, let's take Java. In Java, you have class hierarchies, and sometimes you want to do class hierarchy analysis and use that as a basis for inlining, right? So you run the code, you have the activation on the stack, but suddenly a thread elsewhere will load a new class, and that class will extend the current class hierarchy you depended on, and suddenly your code is invalid. At that point, you have to sort of de-optimize the old code and then try again. Does it make sense? Good. We can take it afterwards if you want. The efficient memory management is also an issue, and most object-oriented programmers, people allocate a lot of temporary objects, and you have to garbage collect them. So in Self, there is also a focus on that one. The interesting part about this, the Self project was that after we sent out releases, people said, well, you're just wasting memory so you can get speed. So they thought that we're actually cheating in some respects. So that caused a small group of us to go to a startup where we made a high-performance Smalltalk system. It was called Strongtalk. It had cool optional typing and what have you. But the interesting part of the work, I thought, was to make a virtual machine for Smalltalk that could demonstrate the techniques from the Self system didn't cause bloat when running on a system. All right? We thought we had a great startup because at that point, that was in the early 90s, Wall Street used Smalltalk for trading systems because they had an easy time doing sort of turnaround time with new features. But in 1995, Sun came out with Java, and sort of all that investment in strange programming languages stopped overnight. And we actually took our Smalltalk VM and converted it into a Java VM that turned into HotSpot. So if you look at the implementation of HotSpot, you'll find meta classes, which is pretty cool. They're not really being used, but they're there. So HotSpot, it's fairly simple. That's an interpreter, because when you have bytecode, it's sort of easy to have an interpreter. And then we had a simple JIT. And then we have a generation-based garbage collection that made allocation and garbage collection go fast. One thing I should say is that before HotSpot, I actually measured and profiled the classic VM, they called it, for a number of applications. And it turned out that a third of the time went into synchronization, a third of the time went into runtime or executing bytecodes, and a third went into doing garbage collection. So you could throw all the compiler expertise you wanted after the system, and you can compute yourself how much faster you'll get Java. So unless you solved all the three categories of problems, you will not get a better system. And that's what we did in HotSpot. So here's, I found the old graph when we sent out the first versions of HotSpot. So we sped up Java with a factor of 2 right out. And then we made it faster in HotSpot 2.0. So that's running the JVM 98 spec suite. So this is unbelievable. They're still doing stuff on HotSpot at Oracle. So I'm glad I cannot see the code. I'm pretty sure it's big and ugly by now. I'm just guessing. I have no idea. So I left the Java a long time ago, but it's still amazing that software you made that many years ago is still around and scary. So here's it's always good to reflect on what you built, right? So HotSpot, so what's good and what's bad? Well, the first implementation of HotSpot was based on conservative garbage collection. And there is, do you all know what conservative garbage collection is? A conservative garbage collection is a garbage collector where you don't really know where all the pointers are, so you treat integers and pointers the same. And that's sort of scary. And so if you look at the Java bytecodes, you will find out there's a bytecode called job subroutine. And the Java C compiler generated bytecodes you cannot do precise garbage collection on. So that was really nasty. And yeah, so we had to fix that. Anyways, another part of the reflection on HotSpot is that this is my first time where we built multi-threaded execution inside the VM. And we had to run on, say, like ions with 72 CPUs. And that was just the bug tape for that was just painful. So spending half a year debugging multi-threaded code is not fun. I hope you'll never do that. So after yet another VM called Monty and an embedded system called OOVM, Google wanted me to build a JavaScript engine. So I didn't know anything about JavaScript when starting in 2006. It was a strange language. I looked at it and say, at least it will be fun to make it fast. I sort of bought into the whole Chrome idea. The idea of the Chrome was to actually spark innovation into the browser industry, right? We wanted to make something that was simple and secure and fast. I guess you all remember where the browser took half the screen, and you only had half a screen for the content, right? The idea with Chrome was to just make a very thin border around it. I guess most browsers are like that now. And then we wanted fast, and I'm into fast, so I took the job and built a team to do V8. And here it is again, and it's important to state it again. If you make it really, really fast, you get new kinds of applications. It's hard to predict what kinds of application you'll get, but when you get the speed, people will use it. Another thing about Chrome is we decided up front to make everything open source so that people could see how we did it, how we made it fast. Because as you probably know, when web application programmers do applications, they program against the sort of lowest common denominator. And you can guess who that was. At least it was a system that whenever they have allocated 1,000 objects, they did a full complete garbage collection. They're from Redmond. By the way, it's all better now. Most browsers are much faster, and this is great. So I looked at my old notes. The first week at Google, I came up with some ideas how to what we wanted with V8. And we simply wanted to make it 10 times faster than the existing JavaScript engines. And we wanted it to scale so that you could allocate many, many objects and make big programs. So that was cool. And then make it open source. for the purpose of raising the performance bar of the industry. So JavaScript was strange. So, you know, an object is just a map, right? You can throw new properties into the object. So there's no structure on it, and it's very hard to try to find common structures when you run a program. So we came up with something called map transitions. It's a simple idea how to create hidden classes, if you will, behind the scenes. Because if we can convert the runtime of JavaScript into hidden classes, we can start applying all the techniques we learned when doing HotSpot and what have you. So that's what we did. And that will enable these standard optimizations like inlining and what have you. And then we decided not to do bytecodes. Right? We took the source code in and we compiled it right away. The CPUs are so fast nowadays, you can just generate native code. And then like the previous VMs, we wanted to have an efficient memory management system. So out of the, even within the first month or so, we wrote a generation-based garbage collector for it. So we didn't integrate it into the browser first. We just did a standalone version. So this is after 4 months. So we had some benchmarks we wanted to run fast on, and this is the result we had. So we were running like 20 some times faster than the existing browser. So that was at least cool. It was of course cheating because it was running outside the browser and we had to integrate with the DOM and all that, but that gave us hope that using these techniques would actually speed up the browser. Let's roll forward. We shipped out the first version of V8 in 2008, and this is a graph that shows you how performance has changed since. It's not bad. Last time you checked, we are pretty much running 100 times faster compared to in 2007 when it comes to JavaScript. That's pretty amazing. And you can also see the competitors are speeding up. And this is great. I love it. So I'll reflect on V8 too. We had no idea about these map transitions, but it turns out people are actually programming in a structured way so we can reconstruct the classes behind the scenes. That's great. We made some mistakes when doing the runtime system by exposing some raw pointers that made it really hard to do garbage collection, but sort of details. But we got some really unexpected users because we made V8 a separate project on code.google.com. Of course, we could get inside Chrome. We also got inside the web browser on Android. But suddenly, they came out with Node.js, which is the server-side JavaScript that runs on top of V8. We didn't see that coming. That was pretty cool. I guess some of you have tried Node.js. Yeah, good. But more surprisingly, Palm shipped a phone with WebOS that's based on V8. We didn't know about it. So they could take the code from the open source repository and just use it. It just says that open source projects, they actually rock. So as you can see, we have done more than 12,000 commits to the code base, so stuff is actually happening in the V8 land still. Oh, geez. JavaScript is faster now, but it's still not my kind of programming language. I think I don't offend anybody if I say that it promotes spaghetti-style programming. Object-oriented programming is hard. It's very hard to sort of model classes in JavaScript. And objects can change on the fly. Like the libraries are objects, so why is that a problem? Well, it's a problem that you can go to the prototype of array and swap push and pop on an array. So you can imagine if you're a big company trying to do independent libraries and you do sort of monkey patching and what have you, suddenly your model does not work anymore, but it's not your fault. Right? So for programming the large, there's real problems. And tool support is also hard. And the reason why it's hard is that you cannot see your program before you execute the code. Right? When you execute the script, you set up the program. And it's very hard for a tool to read that and reason about it. And then there's slow application startup. At Google, we do big apps like Gmail. When you start up Gmail, it can take up to a second on some browsers. And the reason for that is even though we do compression, even though we do minification and tree shaking or what have you, you still have to read in the source code and create the program on the fly. And then my favorite is that in order to make JavaScript fast, we have to focus on only a certain part of JavaScript. So if you use corner cases of the language, the performance will go down the toilet. For instance, try run your favorite program and put delete property in as a call to some of the properties in hot objects, then suddenly your program will go 10 times slower. And it's very hard to sort of reason about why. That's other issues, but so I'm trying to set you up for why we're doing Dart. It's coming now. Here's an example I tried out the other day. So JavaScript has this thing about doing implicit conversions. Try to figure out why that works. It's actually true. And it's only true because if you take it step by step, you'll do, I believe it's 7 implicit conversions, and it'll all fall out to be true. But your head will explode in the meantime. At least I think it's not intentional, but I, I like the web. It's fantastic, right? So developing small applications is easy. It's easy because you have incremental execution. There's no tools in the way when you do scripts. And the first time I started using the web for programming, I felt a little bit like when I did Lisp or Smalltalk in the old days, because you just change the line and you run again, no tools. It's great. We want to get back to that again for other systems. It's also platform independent, and it's everywhere. I have 2 teenage girls at home. They got laptops a few years ago. They have never installed a native application on their laptop. They do everything through the web. So from my point of view, it turns out, well, I'll exclude the mobile world, but at least on desktop systems, the web is pretty much the portal to most people. But again, I think you have to innovate if you want to survive in the long run, and that's the reason why I did that. So again, supporting for programming the large so we cannot do monkey patching and destroy libraries is good. Compared to V8 performance of today, I want a new platform that has 10 times faster startup, right? So when we start up Gmail, if it's written in this new platform, it should just go like this, less than 100 milliseconds. And then I want predictable performance. This is falling apart. Can you hear me now? Two small ears. Wow. Did you hear anything at all before? So this is strange. So I want predictable performance, but I also want it even faster. So for Dart, which is the platform we're talking about, we want at least to be twice as fast as JavaScript peak performance. And then, of course, we have no intent of fragmenting the web. So even though we want to introduce a new programming language, we don't want to make it only work in Chrome. And I'll talk about that a little bit. So here's Dart as a programming language. It's not fancy, on purpose. It has curly braces because it works. It's class-based. It has some, we can use interfaces with default implementation. We have optional static types. I'll come back to that a little bit. And then we have real lexical scoping. It's novel. But it's also simple. We only have a single thread execution. I spent too many years doing JVMs. And one thing I know is most programmers do not know how to do multi-thread programming. Right? That's one of the reasons why enterprise Java beans really work, because people only have to implement sort of single-threaded logic. And I think it's compact and readable. So it's not too bad. So here's the inspiration to Dart. There's nothing new in it. The object model is inspired by Smalltalk. I like Smalltalk. And the compilation strategy inspired by self, that's for the VM part. And then we have optional types inspired by Strongtalk. Isolates design inspired by Erlang. And then we have the nice syntax and constructs inspired by JavaScript and C#. So it's just a melting pot with all kinds of stuff in it. But it's simple to use, and that's important. One thing I should tell you is we've had some hackathons with Dart, and if you have any experience in JavaScript, Java, or C#, you can get up running within an hour or two. And that's exactly the sweet spot we are looking for. With straightforward semantics, if you saw the expression before in JavaScript, you could not get the same result in Dart. Unlike Java, we don't have class initialization, which is very complicated, so it's very simple. And applications are declared. That means that you can have tools that can do refactoring if you want to. And it's really designed for VM. I've done VMs for a longer time. So during the design of the language, we evaluated most of the contracts and made sure that they can be implemented efficiently on a virtual machine. And to me, that matters a lot. Speed is king. I know some scripting language, without mentioning names, don't care about speed, but speed is better. If you have comparable systems, but one system is faster than the other, you'll always take that. So I think that one of the reasons why Chrome is also very appealing to some people is fast, hopefully still is. Here's Dart, very simple. You have a class point, have two fields, x, y. The constructor assigns to the two fields, and you have an operator plus, takes parameter other, and we have a shorthand function syntax. If you only return an expression, you see the arrow. And that's pretty much it. You have the two string that returns a string, where we're using string interpolation. And then you have the top-level main function that creates a 2 points, and then prints out the result. I guess you all can read that. No monads. Sorry, couldn't resist it. Then we add types, if you want to. In Dart, you can add these types, and you can decide when to add it. The only difference between the previous slide and this slide is the green stuff you have. And to some, that increase readability of the programmer, of the program. And that's good. The strange stuff about Dart is that it runs exactly the same on the virtual machine. Types on fields, variables, and what have you is thrown away at runtime. But we can use a static type check on it, and it can find problems in your program if you want to. I guess you're all into covariant generic types and stuff like that, but we support generic types. So here's a small example where we are having a function called pick apples that returns a list of apples, and you pass it to another function that takes list of fruit. And in Dart, it works great because list of apple is a subtype of list of fruit. It's simple to most, but for instance, if you use Java, this will not work. These types will be unrelated. So we have a very simple type system. It's very different from most static type systems. I know there's a lot of Haskell people here, and in Haskell, you have to spend a lot of time getting your program right, so the types work. We actually don't care about that in Dart. We mostly have types, so you can specify the intent with your interface, right? Types can be introduced gradually, and in most cases, your whole program is not typed. Parts of the program is untyped, and part is typed. And that's fine by us. But it'll still give you the safety that if you have a library you've implemented, you can put in types in the interface, and the user of the library can see how it should be used, what kind of types should be passed in for parameters, and so on. We allow implicit downcast, which most people will not like, at least if you're in the hard type theory camp. But it allows us to have a simple programming model, and the way we compensate is that you can run the program in check mode, so where all assignments are evaluated runtime. And type checker will often issue warnings if you run the type checker, but you can still run the program even though you have type errors. So the question is, why do we want that? Well, I talked about incremental execution is important. So if you have a program that's running and there's a bug, you want to pop into the debugger, type an expression, and see how it works. You don't want to struggle with a type system in these cases. We don't want to fragment the web, right? So we have a virtual machine, and we can integrate that in Chrome, which is great because we are in the same company. But convincing the other browser vendors to take our VM is probably a stretch right now because it's not a product and we haven't demonstrated all the features. But we have a tool that will translate Dart into JavaScript. So it runs on all browsers. So you can still use Dart, but still hit all the browsers. We have a SHAP, I assume people are familiar with snapshots from Lisp systems and Smalltalk, yes? A few. So snapshots are cool. That's how we get the fast startup. And a snapshot is just a serialized form of the heap. So you load in the program, and you take the heap representation and serialize that out to a file. The next time you want to run that application, you just suck it in. And that's just 10 times faster than reading the source code and stuff like that. And we support that in the VM. Here's Dart performance. So right now we have this automatically generated chart all programmers see every morning when they come into work, and that shows you how well we are doing compared to V8 in terms of performance. Right now, if you read the Dart column nearly at the end, you can see that on this select set of benchmarks we are running 113% of V8 for benchmarks written in JavaScript. So we're already now faster than JavaScript, and we just get started. We have not turned on inlining yet, so when we do that, you should see, it will be really fast. At the end, you'll see how our Dart to JS compiler is doing. If you take a program in Dart, compile it to JavaScript, and run it on V8, how does it compare to the same program written in JavaScript? And right now we're running 75% of full JavaScript performance. And this will get better. I don't think we'll get better than 100, but hopefully close to. So we're getting ready for shipping a sort of a stable version, a beta, if you will, of the platform. It has a language specification, libraries, virtual machine. And by the way, you can write server code in Dart 2, so the virtual machine can run in standalone. And we have an I/O library that can be used for loading files and handling communication. We have the translator to JavaScript, and we have a Dart IDE that helps you create these programs. And then we have an integration with Chromium, so you can see how it is when the Dart VM is integrated with Chrome. So that's cool. Okay, so now, because I'm an old man, I have to talk about what I've learned so far. I don't know if you can learn anything from it, but this is it. So in all the projects I've done the last 26 years, I've always started with these very small teams. And that really works. It's just like a startup. So don't, when you start a project, don't fill it with people. Do 4 or 5 at most. And focus on the hardest problem first and ignore the rest. It's always a good idea. Like we did the standalone speed for V8. It clears the road. When you can demonstrate good performance early on, right, you get extra time for doing all the integration and the testing afterwards. And then one thing that's great, I don't know if you have it like me, but competition is great. So if you're in an industry where you can compete with other vendors in the same industry, it's just so fun. And I hope you're doing that once in a while. And of course, the last part is, yeah, only hire people that are smarter than you. In my case, that was not a problem. Let's see. I said this before, but open source projects are great. It helps the industry, right? Other people can take it, and if they find a bug, they can fix it. Like, for instance, what's the alternative? The alternative is you buy it from a vendor as a binary system, and you have to integrate it into your system. What if you find a bug? Well, you wait for the next release cycle, because you only have the binary. You cannot fix it, basically. And that's where the open source projects are great, because you can dive in and you can fix the problem and get on with your daily life. And it also keeps your work honest. There's no way you can cheat when you do open source projects. So spoofing and all that kind of stuff is out. I like that. And this is just a common knowledge for most, hopefully. When you build systems where performance is important, you track performance every day. You run all the benchmarks you can get hold of on all revisions, on all platforms, automatically. If not, performance deteriorates. And I've seen this so many times, it's not funny, right? People start focusing on functionality. Over time, performance gets slower and slower, and you're getting close to shipping, and suddenly you have to figure out why it's slow. So in most projects, I'll just set this up no matter what you're doing. We have an automated system, of course, built in Dart. So this is server-side Dart. It's a system that runs all the performance checks on various CPUs. And here you can see how performance is changing over time for one specific benchmark. It's called Delta Blue. It's a constraint solver from University of Washington. Anyways, the good thing is that you can see this dip in performance for the green graph. This is somebody that screwed up the system. And when you make that available to all your programmers, right, they notice right away and they revert the change. If you don't have this automatic testing tool, what will happen is, right, it's probably an added functionality. It'll stay in there, and when you're about to ship, you have to do binary search to find out what caused it. This is much easier. The same with testing. Testing is the same as performance. You have to run all the tests for all revisions on all platforms automatically. If not, quality deteriorates. And we do the same with Dart. So since we don't want to fragment, we test for each revision all the stuff we have on all the browsers we can get hold of, and also, of course, on our own VM. So this is a standard build, but we just throw machines at the problem, and it works. I'm getting So I believe that speed will continue to drive innovation for web applications. We need to make it even faster than this today. It works. But another thing that comes into play is programmer productivity. And we're at a point, in my mind, where JavaScript is not sufficient for writing big applications. That's the reason why we started Dart. You can go look at the code for V8, or look at the Dartlang org site. It's a very active community already now, even though it's not a product, so people are active in helping out and committing changes to our system. So that's pretty much all I have except the last slide. So this is a grid of what I worked on and what kind of features they have. So with that in mind, I think we should open up for questions.
So you talked earlier about getting rid of type information when you're doing JIT. So my question is, let's say that you have a program which, as it happens, ends up populating an array with a bunch of integers. But ahead of time, you didn't declare that it was going to be an array of integers. Maybe you said it was going to be an array of numbers, or maybe you even just said it was going to be a heterogeneous list. Is there actually, you know, given the optimizations that you do, is there actually any performance gain to being more specific about that, or is it all going to end up having the same performance characteristics under one of these VMs anyway?
On Dart, it doesn't make a difference, because the types we have are interface types, they're not implementation types.
What about V8?
It's the same, but they, in V8 it's getting weirder and weirder. They so it has changed. So a VM, this is also weird. So here it is. Arrays usually just contains objects, right, or values in JavaScript. But behind the scenes, we are trying to make it better. So on the fly, we are actually tracking today in V8 whether all the elements are doubles. If they are all doubles, at some point we will convert the representation into a double array. And so that all the double values are stored in the array, and if that assumption is violated, right, we do the optimization again and revert the representation to just having ordinary objects inside. So we try to recognize behind the scenes what the actual values are in the array and capitalize on that. But that's a big hammer to have.
Do you go beyond double, like to integer, or is double as fine grained as you get?
Well, in JavaScript, there's no integers.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Of course. next question. Okay, the question is, did the map transition scheme come from self? And the answer is no. We had maps in self, so that's where the similarities stop. The transitions are actually a way of capturing how an object is morphed when you start adding property to it. In self, when you did program changes, that was more like a reflective kind of thing. Whereas in JavaScript, it just happens on the fly when you're adding properties to an object. Yes, that's another question.
For Dart, what were your considerations for optional immutability, or better yet,
Oh, that's a long discussion. So this is about immutability versus mutability of stuff. There's different ways of handling it. We talked about it a lot. In particular, we talked about splitting the class hierarchy up so that you have mutable classes and immutable classes, but it turns into a mess, basically. So right now, we have it so that if you try to mutate an immutable object, you get a runtime error in our system. So that's a simple solution, but that's, I think, is a compromise we had to make so that people can understand what's going on. If you make the mutability part of the normal type structure or class hierarchy, I think it gets too complicated. We have, however, const objects in Dart, which is compile time computed objects you can have. And the main reason for doing that is that because we have this isolate concept, And when you communicate between two isolates on the same virtual machine, you can actually pass a pointer to these const objects because they're immutable. That's the reason why I did that. Yes? That's a good question. What would we like to see in Dart? So there certainly has been some constraints because we had to translate into JavaScript. So the JavaScript translation has been a big part of this language problem. When we started the Dart language, I wanted to have fractions and stuff like in Smalltalk, because then you could do precise computation and stuff like that. We took that out, mostly because of JavaScript. There's been many things we would like to have in, and the community gave us a lot of response in the beginning, say, why didn't you put in this fancy feature? And the answer is that the people we're aiming at, they should be able to understand the semantics of the program language without being sort of a computer scientist. So we really went for a very low bar in terms of semantic complexity of the programming language. So there's a lot of stuff we haven't put in. But you think it's still compact and usable as a programming language, but I'm probably the wrong person to answer that part. The question is it not possible to implement snapshot for startup in V8? Kinda. We actually have implemented it in V8, and we use it for the JavaScript library, because that's also written in JavaScript. That's how we suck it into V8, is using a snapshot. But you can only do it if the snapshot is crafted in a specific way. In particular, it cannot have any side effects when you're setting up the program structure. And that's actually very hard to compute or tell programmers they should not do that if they want to use snapshots. So it can only be used for certain kind of handcrafted JavaScript files, like the basic library. Yes, the question is, can we retain the source information in snapshots? It's already done, of course.
So you said you don't have a hash or something. Do you have any other numeric types, or is it really just double still? Like you have byte or?
No, we have integers. Okay. So the VM has real integers. They don't wrap around. They just overflow into big integers. So you have a fairly good semantics. The problem is when you translate to JavaScript, it gets more complicated because you can only use 53 bits. If you get beyond that, it turns into a double and you're a host. So that's a difference between the Dart to JS semantics and the Dart VM. I actually like integers. I think they're great. So I don't want to make nums into doubles only. The question is, are we able to leverage the optional types for optimizations? Yes or no? In the Dart VM, we don't use them at all. They're thrown out when you start up, so there we don't. When we translate to JavaScript, we use it a lot. So the performance you see, the 75% of normal JavaScript, we use the type system, and we also do other stuff for doing type inferencing and making sure we can tree shake and make it small and stuff like that. But in the VM, it doesn't really matter. Also, because it's partial information. In many cases, people write untyped code and only plaster types on the interfaces, which is perfectly fine in our system. Or do we have reified type information? And the answer is yes. So you can ask if it's a list of apples. Yes?
So you mentioned earlier that you like integers, but JavaScript only supports doubles. Is there any possibility, since you know you're writing the VM for obviously a platform where you can have integers, of doing the same kind of inference that you were talking about earlier, figuring out that what you're working with is an integer, and then storing it that way, and then if it turns out not to be, then de-optimize it?
Oh, believe me, we are already doing that big time. But I was talking more in the sense of from the program's point of view. from the program's point of view, you have doubles, right? Behind the scenes, we do all kinds of weird stuff to make it run fast, and we have to. Yes?
On the chart, what's the difference between a green and a red circle and
Great question. The green stuff is where I actually learned the technique. That's a long time ago. So I learned a lot of stuff in a self-project, it seems. The slashes are sort of not really multi-threaded, sort of cooperative scheduling here and there. Open source, like HotSpot is open source. And for instance, with incremental execution, Dart is, we don't support that yet in the VM, but it's just a matter of next version will have that. So I was just trying to capture what I worked on. It was actually cool to do. But there's a lot of similarities. And you can see the left one is called precise garbage collection. It's important. So you take last question. Yes. Oh, yeah, that's one over here I didn't ask before.
Part of the popularity of JavaScript is its connection to object literals is JSON. Is there anything similar in Dart?
Yeah, we have this class called a map. You can create a similar kind of structure. So when you decode JSON, it turns into lists and maps. Does that answer the question? Sorry. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much for listening.